Say these words, in the name of Jesus. In the name, come on, say it again. Of Jesus. Come on now. Say it again, like you mean it. In the name. All right, say it after me, okay? In the name of Jesus. That's enough right there. That's enough right there. Amen. When we were at council the other couple of weeks back, there was a song, and I'm going to share that song with you at the end of this message. And I'm going to invite you to come up to this altar and just whatever, in whatever capacity you want to come, to worship, to bring something to the Lord, whatever it is. But I know we say the name of Jesus in the name of Jesus, but I really want to just, I'm going to just dig into this. We know the benefit on our side of what we got, what Jesus came. Right? We know the benefits. A lot of us know the benefits of what we have received because of what Jesus and what God did for us. But what I want to kind of share with you this morning is a perspective from the other side. What was going on with God while all this was going on, these thousands of years that he was separated from his most prized creation, which was you and I, human beings, mankind. And I want to kind of just look at it from that aspect today. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 through 11. Let me start right there. Philippians chapter 2, and there it is up on the screen here. It says, therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. I want to pray. Father, today I just want to say thank you that we can come to you right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, through the person of Jesus. And Lord, we're just so grateful for that. And Lord, today I pray you'll just help me to share something that will just help us, Lord, even to understand just how important that is and what that truly means when we talk about coming to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we bless you today, God. Please just help me to give me the words to say and just to share with your people this morning that will help them. And God, we just thank you for it in your precious name. Amen. Hey, one more quick announcement, real quick. This week is the National Day of Prayer. Okay, so at Great Bethel, if you can attend from 12 to 1 o'clock this Thursday at Great Bethel Missionary Baptist Church, we're going to have from 12 to 1 just an hour of prayer for our nation and the different things in our, government, military, just different categories. And so if you can make that, it's going to, again, be at Great Bethel Missionary Baptist, okay? So let's get back to this. The name of Jesus. Why is it so important? And I think to really understand really why the name of Jesus is so important, we got to go all the way back to the beginning, okay? God had created the heavens and the earth. Think about that. God created the heavens and the earth there in Genesis chapter 1. He's talking about all the things that he did. But then he gets down to where he creates man. All right, and that's down in verse 26 and 27. It says, then God said, let us make man. There's the Trinity, by the way, when it says let us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. The image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. So God had created everything else, but guess who he created it for? Us. I want you to get that for a second. He created the atmosphere, the air, the grass, the everything that we would ever need. Okay, before then he created man. And you just think of how powerful that is, just showing what just all that God went through so that we could have this earth the way it is. And we all have heard this before about how the sun is just at the perfect distance from the earth and all of that, that if we were any further away, we'd freeze to death too close and we'd burn up. I mean, God, it was just so detailed, but what I want you to get is he did it for us. Amen. He did it for us because he did all that, and then he created man and said, here you go, look what I've done for you. Amen? And so there was a relationship, as we know, between God and man. You know, matter of fact, in the book of Luke, chapter 3, verse 38, and I don't know if I've got this one, Zach, but it just simply says this, Luke refers to Adam as the Son of God. In that genealogy, he comes in and says, and Adam, the Son of God. What I'm trying to get you to understand is about this relationship. And I want you to see things this morning from God's side of it. They had this very unique relationship, God and Adam and Eve. The Bible doesn't really talk much about was there a physical appearance of God, but it does say that they heard the sound of him walking in the cool of the day and all of this, and it's found in Genesis chapter 3, verses 8 through 10, where it says, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves. Well, let me back up. Let me just stop right there. He went there in the cool of the day. So they did. They had this unique relationship with God, where they maybe didn't see him physically, but they knew his voice. They talked to him. It's like they had this communication one to another. And then, because the verses go on there, after verse 8, and verses 9 and 10, it says, but the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? This is after they, of course, had taken from the tree that God said not to take from. And he said, where are you? And they said, well, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. So what I want you to get through all of this right now is not the fact that about hiding himself and all that right now. What I want you to see is there was this conversation. They were used to talking to one another. Amen. You see what I'm saying? And so you wonder, you know, we talk about, well, you know, Adam had a great, you know, this relationship with God, and here it is. It wasn't unusual for them just to talk to one another. And you can just see that in the way they were just talking and going back and forth right here, okay? And so what happened? Well, like we said, they took from that tree that God said, don't take from it. And God had to put them, literally the Bible says, and we're going to look at that, he drove them out of his presence. He drove them out of his presence right there, you know, and what drives us out of God's presence is sin, right? And God told him, look, you know, when you take of that tree, you will surely do what? You will surely die, all right? And so there was we're not just talking about physical death, because we know they didn't drop dead right there on the spot, right? Because if he was talking about that, I mean, they would have just ate that fruit and boom, they'd have been out. But God said, no, there's going to be you're going to be separated from what really is life, and that's me. God said, I'm really life. I'm your ultimate source. And to be separated from me is death. Okay? And so that's what God was telling them. And the Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. And so God pronounced this judgment upon Adam and Eve as a result of their rebellion. And in verse 24, he says this, he drove out the man. And at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. And notice it says he drove them out. In other words, it's like God saying, it was almost like saying they didn't want to go. Would you? Well, you've been in perfect paradise, and all of a sudden you've had this relationship with God, and you've been intimate and talking back and forth, and all of a sudden you do the one thing he says don't do, and they didn't know the consequences because God said he'd already told Adam, if you do it, you will surely die. They didn't know what death was. Okay, I don't know that they even knew what death was even about, but when they had this disconnect, they knew something had changed. They felt like they had to hide themselves, like they were naked and just exposed in a way they'd never felt before. And they felt embarrassed and shameful to even be in the presence of God anymore. And so they went and hid themselves. And God, you know, of course he knew where they was at, but he asked them a question, where are you? Do you think God knew where they were at? Well, of course he did. All right, but he wanted them to know where they're at, okay? And so there was a separation. It literally says he had to drive them out because I'm sure I wouldn't. The Bible doesn't give us all the details, but I'm wondering if maybe said, God, please. You know, I don't know what happened. But he says he drove them out, and then he placed a cherub, which was some kind of angelic being, and then this it says a flaming sword, and it guarded the tree of life that they couldn't come up at it from any direction, even if they wanted to. I mean, it was guarded. And he drove them out. And so there was this disconnect, this separation from God, okay? So it began. Listen, this 4,000-year span of time where mankind had not been able to be in the presence of God. I want you to think about that. We're thinking about from 4,000 years between Adam and the time of Christ, all right? So for 4,000 years, God, who once had a relationship with man, was now not able to do it. Now, I know how we feel on our side of that, but I just want you to think about how God and what heaven was like and what it was like for him that his most prized creation wasn't able to come to him and talk to him and have that relationship. Just think about that for a second. Think about that. 4,000 years span of time. Now, we know the Bible says 1,000 years is like a day. So to God, it might have been 4 days. I don't know. All right? But I'm saying for us, we, you know, 4,000 years. Imagine that. And couldn't come directly to God. But So I want you to see God's side of this. Because we know that God loved the world, right? What does the John 3:16 say? For God so loved the world. So we know that God has such a love for this world, and he longs for a relationship for us, and he wanted it to be restored. And so God started a plan. The very day they failed, God already started a plan that would bring us back to him. Now, you may not see it because, you know, some people don't realize this about this particular scripture, but I want to show you this in Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 and 15, how God had already started this plan of redemption. And it says this, it says, so the Lord God said to the serpent, he's putting the curse on the serpent here because of how he deceived Adam and Eve. He says, I will put enmity between you, Satan, and the woman, and your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Now we know that this serpent was Satan because of what Revelation says. Revelation chapter 20 says this, it says, then I saw an angel coming down from heaven holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he seized the dragon, that ancient serpent. So that was the description of Satan all the way back in the garden. Okay? And he said he grabbed this ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. So God told this serpent, who was Satan here in the story, I will put enmity. That means hostility, even a hatred between her seed and your seed. But notice, I want you to say it said the woman's seed. Now, in the Bible, when you're talking about the seed, the seed was always passed through the man. The only way that there could be a woman's seed or something of that nature is that she didn't have a husband. Think about that. And guess who didn't have a husband as far as when Jesus came along? Born of a virgin, right? And so he says there's going to be enmity between her seed, in other words, someone who would come through, you know, her in a supernatural way, and you. And, of course, that was right then. I just want you to see that that was the very first mention of God's plan of redemption, of how he was going to bring about this process of bringing us back to himself. So for God, because of his love for mankind, he established a plan the very day that we were separated from him. And also through those 4,000 years, okay, from the time of Adam and Eve up until Jesus, God was still trying to make himself known to man. Think about this. One of the first men he really made himself known to was Noah. Think about that. In Noah's time, we saw what the world would be like without God's presence. The Bible says that every intention of man was just to do evil. Can you imagine that? Well, we kind of can't we, in a way? Okay, we can see that kind of in our culture a little bit. But just imagine if it's everybody but you. Think about that. And God was getting ready to flood the whole earth, but he found one man. We ought to be thanking God for Noah. Come on now. He found one righteous man, okay, of all those that would not do what God asked. And that's, again, Noah's a type of Christ. Think about that. One man changed the world, right? One man made a difference. Praise God. And then after Noah's time, God was still reaching out to us in some kind of relationship type, because he found this man named Abram, whom we all know as who? Abraham, right? Okay? And from himself, God himself was going to get with Abraham and create a people for himself out of mankind. And we know those people now today, of course, to be the Israelites. And God established this covenant relationship between himself and Abraham and his descendants. And the covenant worked this way. Look, I'm going to do my part, and then you do your part. Okay? Now, the problem was God always did his part, but they never kept their part. They couldn't do it. They just kept going after other gods and things like this. And so God was trying to have this relationship. And then God raised up another man. We know him as Moses. Okay? Through God, God gave him the commandments, his commandments. Okay? In hopes that his people, his mankind, and his people in particular, the Israelites, who he wanted to influence the world, he wanted them to follow after him. He wanted them to have this relationship with him. All right? But of course, we know again, that didn't work out. All right? They broke the commandments that God had established. So think about this. God had this relationship with us, with mankind. It was close. They were walking together, talking together. Sin separated because he disobeyed God. God drove him out of God's presence. But then 4,000 years in the making, God was still reaching out to us through Noah, Abraham, Moses, just reaching out to his creation. And nothing was sufficient until one day God said, 4,000 years later, okay, think about this. Even Malachi is your last book in your Old Testament. There's 400 years between that Old Testament book and when what we know as the New Testament starts. So, I mean, it was just a dark time. No one had even heard from God. It was like it was just a silent period. It's like God was not speaking at all that we are aware of, that were recorded. And so it was like, but for 4,000 years, God was saying, I'm trying to reach out to you. I'm trying to reach out to you. I'm trying to reach out to you, but no one's responding. So you know what he did? He said, I'm going to come down there. Hallelujah. I'm going to come down there. Praise God. Whew, I get tingles. Amen. Listen to what the Bible says in Galatians. It says this, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of woman. Notice that? The woman's seed. Remember we talked about that? Born under the law to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoptions as sons. And because you are sons and daughters, okay, that's how it's written, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Couldn't do that before. 4,000 years, okay? The only person that could even go into the presence of God, and that was once a year, was the high priest, okay? He was the only one that could go right directly into the presence of God, all right? And he couldn't do that without the shedding of blood. He had to do something to take care of his own sin, and blood, animals, of innocent animals had to be sacrificed. And so, but now 4,000 years later, God says, I'm putting forth the plan that I started the very day Adam and Eve sinned. I put this plan, and I had this plan in mind, and I have been trying to do it, and now this is the time. And then he came to this world. Praise God. So, God sent his son, Jesus, who paid the penalty for Adam and Eve's sin, their disobedience, by dying for us. In other words, you see, it's not a particular sin, a particular sin that separates you from God. It's that sin of Adam and Eve that separated all of us from God. And that's what Jesus came to pay the price for, that ultimate sin problem that started way back with Adam and Eve. God came to change that, okay? He came to do that. Now, I get excited about this because listen what the Bible says. Jesus paid the wage of our sin. The Bible says what? The wages of sin is? Okay. All right. So Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. Amen. Come on, will you say, in the name of Jesus?
In the name of Jesus.
Come on now. Think about that. Jesus said three words on that cross. Well, he said several, but the three particular words, what? It is finished. Wow. Think about that. For 4,000 years, no communication with God like he wanted, like he had with us, with mankind, with Adam and Eve. Couldn't do that. But when those three words, and then, of course, we know Jesus rising from the dead, right? Those three words was saying, and you know what happened at the moment that those three words were spoken? The Bible says in the temple where there was the Holy of Holies and the holy place, there was this curtain separating the two. And that was just saying that, man, basically that curtain was basically saying, you cannot get to me. But if you read your Bible, you'll notice that when Jesus said those words, it is finished, all of a sudden in the temple, that veil was ripped from the top to the bottom, showing that God tore it. Amen? God tore it. Hallelujah. God tore it. That in the name of Jesus, we could enter in to that relationship with our Father once again. Oh, my Lord, that is so awesome when you think about that. Listen to what Jesus said in the Gospel of John. He says, until now you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive that your joy may be full. What really should fill us with joy is our relationship with God.
Amen.
Amen? Come on now. That should be the most important relationship in your life. And if it's not, check it. Okay? Because that needs to be the most important thing. You want to be the best husband, the best wife, the best employer, son, daughter, parent, whatever, then be the best Christian you can be. Amen? Get close to God, and he's going to help you in all those relationships. Because in him is the fullness of joy. Because he said, you've not asked anything in my name until now. You've asked nothing. And he says, ask, and you will receive that your joy may be full. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf. Notice what he says. I will not ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you. Your Father loves you. Now, I don't care what kind of relationship you've had with your earthly dad. Your Heavenly Father loves you. He loves you desperately. He put this plan into motion. It took 4,000 years before he could see this thing come back together again. And that's the part that I really wanted to focus on. God had been separated. Man had been separated from God 4,000 years, and heaven was waiting to reconnect with mankind. Now the price had been paid and access had been made. And you know what heaven wanted? I wish you could picture this. I wish there was just a way. You know, when we were praising the Lord a while ago in the praise and worship time, I could just in my mind's eye just see, I don't know, this the praise is kind of going up into heaven. But you know what? They couldn't do that before. But you know what was heaven was waiting for? That in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, if you can just imagine this the way I kind of look at it is like maybe some clouds or whatever, and all of a sudden here comes these prayers, these words, these praises coming through those clouds and entering into the presence of God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Do you get that? So powerful, that name of Jesus. 4,000 years, the name above all names. That's why Jesus said, I am the only way to the Father. No one can come to the Father except through me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Okay? That's why the name of Jesus, that's why at the name of Jesus, every tongue will confess and every knee will bow that He is Lord. Because at and in the name of Jesus, now for the very first time, it was like the Father was, I can just imagine Him being up there and just all of a sudden, here's that name. Father, someone prays. Very first prayer. I wonder what it was like. One of the first prayers of someone on the earth after Jesus did all that He did. And all of a sudden someone says, Father, in the name of Jesus. Man, it was like, oh, I've been longing to hear that for a long time. In the name of Jesus, I come to You. Not in the name of any other God, but in the name of Jesus. And I can just imagine the Father begins to hear these prayers, and all of a sudden He begins to hear these praises that are coming up all because of this plan that He put into motion 4,000 years ago before then. Can you just think about that? How precious. And I wanted you to kind of see it from God's aspect. I know what it meant for us, but I want you to know what it meant for God. Amen. To restore that relationship, being restored. In the name of Jesus, we can come to our Father, our Creator, the lover of our soul. Praise God. He's made it possible in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Your Father in heaven wants to have a relationship with you, and it's been made possible through Jesus' name. So please don't ever look at God in some religious way. You know, don't look at God as a bunch of do's and don'ts, because God is all about relationship. He wants that relationship with you, to know Him, walk with Him, to love Him. Praise God. That's really all I've got to share this morning. And that's, when I say that's all, that's a lot. I just want you to get that. The name, I want you to say it again, in the name of Jesus. And just think about that. I couldn't help it. When he's down in worship, and it was like I could just see the words, and they were just penetrating where they couldn't penetrate before because of what Jesus did. And see, God wants to hear from you in the name of Jesus. He wants to hear from you. He wants to hear about your problems and your victories. He just wants to know all about your life. He wants you just to be honest and real with Him and just, here's another one. There's another prayer in the name of my Son. Ha, hallelujah. Praise God. This is what I'm going to do. I said there was a song I wanted to share with you. And I want this to be a time for you just to worship the Lord. But when I heard this song, this is what inspired this message. But it just blessed my socks off, you know. And so I just want us, we're going to bring down the lights, okay. We're going to play this song. And I can't even remember the name of the song. Some of you are probably going to ask me afterwards. But anyway, feel free to come to the altar, whatever you want to do. If you want to just come and praise the Lord in the name of Jesus, if you want to come up here and just bring a need to Him in the name of Jesus, do that. Because that's what He desires. He put forth a plan so that you could talk to Him, so that you could worship Him. And not only is it benefiting us, I want you to know God is, He is blessed by that. He is... It ministers to God. I mean, it's, amen. I mean, how does it feel when someone that you truly love talks to you? Amen. It makes you feel good. It's good to know that you're loved, right? There's no greater feeling to know that there's someone that talks to you because they love you and they want to be with you. I want you to know, I want you to see it from God's side. And He said, I'm going to make this plan so that I can have that again with my creation. So let's stand to your feet and let's worship with this song. And feel free, like I said, if you just want to come in the name of Jesus and just bring your praise or just bring your needs, whatever it is. But I just want you to know it's in the name of Jesus that we can do that. Go ahead, Zach.